Good morning. I am trying very hard to wake up. So you have to forgive me if I sound like I am still asleep. thank you so very much for welcoming me to what I consider a very important conversation on our continent. The collaboration between the Legaton Institute and the Ford Foundation, as representative of Ford Foundation for East Africa was saying, is really a demonstration of what collaborative partnership is all about, and any of the things that will succeed in this millennium have to be based on collaborative partnership. The time has ended when one cock crew in the community, effectively. And talking about cock, I am so delighted to see that there will be many hens also crowing in this conference. I've been asked to speak on, maybe that went over the head of some of the people around here, but when we talk about cock, we mean a man. Huh? When we talk about the hen, we mean the women. So with a very good list of women that you have unfolded, we'll be speaking at this conference. I am very glad that many will be speaking. It's not going to be a bunch of men telling us how to make Africa prosperous, because they alone cannot make it happen. Yes, the women can clap if they want. And I could also see that the very decent men clapped also. I've been asked to speak on the topic, unlocking Africa's potential. I was recently, maybe not too recently, but I forget. I think it must have been earlier this year. I was a guest of my dear friend Richard Dowden in London, and at the Royal Society for Africa. And when Richard asked me what I was going to speak on, I said, "Africa rising. Wait until the citizens arise." In many ways, I see an intersection between what I had said at that event and what I am going to be saying today. It is essentially that the summary of what I will be saying today is that it is the citizens of Africa that are Africa's locked-up potential. And so the summary is liberate the citizens of Africa to create the prosperity that Africa is in need of. But I'll finally get to that simple point by taking you through a journey. The way that I always look at the things in recent times has been to take a historical, a phases approach. And I was thinking, why have you suddenly started thinking in terms of eras and seasons? I realized that it happened as soon as I celebrated my 50th birthday. Age began to reflect in the way that I think. And so in doing this today, I decided that it was best to look at Africa from an era mapping of how we have come. And so the first era for me was the pre-colonial era. Africa's pre-colonial economy was agrarian, as history tells us, with abundance of land, even if negligible irrigation, purely rain-fed agriculture. But it was abundance of land. At that time, Africa was trading with the rest of the world. with a diversity of trade routes and networks that linked key empires on the continent with one another, as well as to distant lands. Trade with the Arab world was well established through the Sahara route, and history does show that diverse goods traveled from Africa onto Europe, Arabia, India, and as far as China. That's why the Chinese are usually angry when people say they discovered relationship with Africa. They say, no, we were trading with Africa way back. For example, until the discovery of the Americas, Mali, Nigeria's little bit of a distant neighbor, but not too distant in West Africa, was the principal producer of gold. Africa ivory was also sought after because it is softer than from the Indian elephant, and therefore easier to carve. History says that because slaves were wanted by the courts of Arab and Berber princes as servants, concubines, soldiers, and agricultural laborers, that business also thrived in pre-colonial Africa. At that time, education was informal and was a vehicle for delivering basic skills in farming, lumbering, iron smithing, and for passing on ethos and values of the communities, their beliefs. Although historians are divided on this, not all of pre-colonial Africa was poor, as is often suggested. Even if this were true, Africa was considered not to have been worse than most of today's upper, middle, and middle-income economies. For example, the historian John K. Turton argues that sub-Saharan Africa was relatively wealthy and technologically advanced until at least the 17th century. Even scholars who believe that Africa was generally poorer than the rest of the world throughout its history make exceptions for certain parts of Africa. Acemoglu and Robinson, I'm sure you know them. You cannot be at this conference without knowing these two authors. The World, Why Nations Fail. They argue that most of Africa has always been relatively poor, but then stated that Aksum, Ghana, Sonhe, Mali, and Great Zimbabwe were probably as developed as their contemporaries anywhere in the world. Oh, by the way, where is Yao? Yeah. You can relate to that. Yao was my colleague and director when we were both at the World Bank. He was the director of our human development. Of course you should be here. He was director of our human development department in the Africa region at the World Bank. And he's from Ghana, so he can relate to this. So that's pre-colonial. Colonial Africa saw the scramble for Africa and the ensuing Berlin Conference and the partitioning into protectorates, colonies, and outposts. And with these, the colonizing powers basically engaged in extractive control and dominance of the conquered territories of Africa. By the 19th century, following the collapse of the profitability of slave trade, the abolition of slave trade, as well as the expansion of the European capitalist industrial revolution, the imperative of the colonizing powers became more and more assured sources of raw materials. And the search for markets and profitable investment outlets. And Africa provided it for the different powers. European appetites for goods such as palm oil, rubber, cotton, precious metals, spices, and other goods made the extractive arrangement, which had no requirement for lasting institutions, the basis of the relationship with Africa. In such an arrangement, the type of education necessary was a function of what the colonial power simply needed for basic administrative purpose. It was the beginning of formal education through Christian missionaries. Officially, education of Africans was considered a tool for basic literacy for the limited number of people that were needed by the colonial powers to sustain their administrative functions that the home offices in their capitals required. Of course, simply on the basis of this economic, social, and political imperative of the colonial powers, education remained capped at that level for majority of Africa's population. Then I jumped to post-colonial Africa of the 60s and 70s. The first decade of independence across the continent, the 60s, Africa showed a strong but short-lived trend up of growth rates. The optimism of independence and the freedom that came with it initially masked the underlying issues of suspended ethnic distrust, rivalries, and animosities when all the groups in each of the countries managed to forge together a common interest to show the colonial powers the door. But as soon as the common foe was out of the door, in most of the countries, there failed to be a conversation on what to do with the new freedom. So the early years of independence were relatively peaceful. However, with most of the countries failing to forge and negotiate a rallying economic vision as a path to prosperity. It did not take time for the center to stop to hold. You reminded me of Chinua Achebe. Very soon, optimism gave room to squabbles. It did not help that the nationalists who had led the political independence effort didn't give adequate attention to the entirely different issue of economic independence. Therefore, most of post-colonial African economies continued to mirror and to operate the extractive structure of their economies as it was under colonial rule. Worse was that by the later 60s and leading up to the 70s, as Africa's political elite squabbled over political power, it was actually a proxy fight for which group will dominate control of the rents from the extractive economies. The vision for transforming the economies in order to generate economic growth and development was left languishing while the fight went on over political control. And so, in this season, the populations expanded, but they expanded to be dropped into poverty because there was no expansion of economic opportunities driven by economic vision. Are you following my map so far? So political instability, conflicts, undemocratic acts, outlawing of political opposition, rising dictatorships, one-party states, and such like, all aberrations became prevalent during this period across the spectrum on the continent. The good news, however, was that it was also during this period that access to primary and secondary education expanded beyond the very limited focus and target of the colonial powers. It was also the period that saw the emergence of top public universities, a handful of them. So the Makereres of this world, right? And which was the one here in University of Dar es Salaam? And of course, our own famous ones like Ibadan and the likes. This was when they came to their own. So I quickly moved to the 80s and the 90s, leading up to the turn of the millennium, and now. By the 80s, the entrapment of the extractives saw Africa and African countries enjoying a series of booms which were quickly followed by busts. And the busts resulted in serious challenges of economic poor performance and poverty. But the best indicator of this was that considerable external debt had become an albatross to the development of the continent. This debt albatross became a hindrance, further impoverishing the citizens of the various countries on the continent. The way out of this became programs of the Bretton Woods institutions, one of which I, as you know, I worked for at the World Bank. And so the 80s and the 90s became the period of structural adjustment programs. Very painful programs anchored on neoliberal economic policies of the Washington Consensus. Extremely painful macroeconomic structural adjustments across the continent, with one visible accomplishment: a force to adjust the pattern of economic management to achieve critical economic fundamentals. Unsparing of Africa in any way and refusing to accept any African exceptionalism. And then the 2000s, having painfully accomplished relative macroeconomic stability as a result of the painful adjustments across the respective countries, economic historians say that those adjustments simply achieved one thing. It awoke Africa to the fact that there are some universal applications in the way that economies are run. And that just like families and individuals, no country has the right to spend what it does not have. And so that key lesson of fiscal prudence and the necessary monetary policies that went with them helped to establish Africa as a place with relative macroeconomic stability. And that became the key feat accomplished by the continent during that era. The era then resulted over time in the Africa Rising story. And what are the indicators of this era of the Africa Rising? Well, to answer this, I mischievously decided that I would quote the recent and succinct picture of Africa Rising by the same magazine that once called it the hopeless continent. The Economist. According to The Economist, sub-Saharan Africa has made a huge leap in the last decade. Malaria deaths in some of the worst affected countries have declined by 30%, and HIV infections by up to 74%. Life expectancy across Africa has increased by about 10%, and child mortality rates in most countries have been falling steeply. A booming economy has made a big difference. Real income per person has increased by more than 30%, whereas in the previous 20 years, it shrank by nearly 10%. Africa is the world's fastest growing continent just now. Over the next decade, its GDP is expected to rise by an average of 6% a year, not least thanks to foreign direct investment, which has risen from $15 billion in 2002 to $37 billion in 2006 and $46 billion in 2012. End of quote. They had to apologize using data. It was very, very wrong for a newspaper to sit in editorial privilege and comfort and write off an entire continent of people whose potentials were yet to be unleashed. And so we see from the way that the economist captures the progress that the continent has made, that the economist was looking into the future of your conference. Because your conference is saying economic growth is welcome. However, it is not sufficient. There has to be a multidimensional approach to accepting growth. The growth of the economy of a country is not necessarily coterminous with the growth of the citizens of the country. Are we together? Such impressive economic feat by Africa as repentantly laid out explicitly by the economists did not just happen. I was recently in the States and I had the good fortune of sitting for a few, for some 2 hours or so with Negroponte. Some of you remember Negroponte, the US Deputy Secretary of State. And Homeland Security at some point. And he said, things don't just happen. People make things to happen. So Africa's economic turning did not just happen. It was made to happen. Effort went into accomplishing it. And it is the same effort, it is the same deliberateness, the same intentionality that would move Africa from mere, nominal, and perhaps real increase in its growth to becoming a continent where prosperity touches on the average citizen of each of the countries. The enduring improvement in macroeconomic conditions on the continent puts Africa in a very enviable position, where it is now sometimes used as an example for some of the countries that used to give it lectures on how to manage its economy. I certainly had a good, you know, it was mixed, bittersweet during the financial crisis and the economic crisis. when African economies managed to keep their senses together. And some of the countries in Europe and North America were struggling to keep their own senses together because macroeconomic fundamentals were healthier on the continent of Africa than they were in these other economies. And sometimes I couldn't help it. I would say, physician, heal thyself. So the important sound economic fundamentals that presaged the growth that we have seen on the continent cannot in any way be taken for granted. Because macroeconomic stability, though not sufficient, is a necessary condition for sustaining growth. And for those who think that growth is a contemptuous thing not to acknowledge, it is important to say to you that without growth, you don't even stand a chance of reducing poverty and improving household income in any of these economies. In a recent report by Ernst & Young, it reported that Africa's regulatory, legal, and business environment has improved. According to the World Bank's 2013 Doing Business report, among the 50 economies globally that have most improved their regulatory environment for business since 2005, the largest share, a third, are in sub-Saharan Africa. No wonder sectors like telecom, which has shown what is possible through a combination of prudent macroeconomic management and sectoral level reforms, are contributors to the Africa Rising narrative. The liberalization and deregulation of the telecom sector succeeded in showcasing Africa as capable of its own revolution. When it went from just under 20 million telephone handsets, telephone lines, to over 600 million handsets within a decade. And so there was agrarian revolution, there was industrial revolution, wasn't Africa's revolution. But Africa has its own revolution, the ICT revolution. The financial sector and others like housing, construction, and consumer trade have also benefited from expansion of private sector investment and helped to sustain the growth trajectory. The commodity boom also had a salubrious effect on the growth of the continent, although some make the mistake of attributing all of Africa's growth to commodity boom. Data proves otherwise. Until the recent declining fortunes of natural resources in the global economy, at least two-thirds of African countries with one resource or another enjoyed the benefits of expanded revenue. However, it is factually incorrect to assume that that explains all of Africa's growth and the Africa Rising story. Because only one third of Africa's growth was delivered by the boom in natural resources. So one key point necessary for our conversation on prosperity of Africa and Africans, and therefore unlocking their opportunity, is to take a multidimensional and broader perspective that interrogates the quality and the structure of the present growth. Ladies and gentlemen, in the same era of the Africa Rising, the paradox of Africa's educational attainment vis-a-vis its burgeoning population. The Africa Rising has led to many more being left behind in terms of the preparation to enable them participate in the benefit of growth. And that is what explains the disconnect between growth and growing inequality in some of the African countries. So this has been an era where, although many more have been able to go to school and to pursue academic endeavors up to tertiary level, compared to the population that has not had the same opportunity, they are smaller in number. What this has meant is that Africa struggles with low productivity and lack of competitiveness. And this is the centrality of how prosperous countries become. The conversation for this era, therefore, has to become, how do we raise Africans' productivity index? It is unfortunate that at a time of economic growth, there is such low productivity and negligible structural change to the extractive economy of the colonial era, such that the lack of expansion of economic opportunities has meant that high unemployment of as much as 30% across the continent questions the growth story. Ladies and gentlemen, with this obvious paradox, economic growth standing side by side still very deep poverty of at least 45% on the continent, the urgency to engage in the dialogue on redressing the drivers of inequality makes your conference most auspicious. I absolutely agree with Mukisa Kituyi, the head of the UN Conference on Trade and Development, that economic growth that does not create decent jobs in sufficient quantities is unsustainable. Prosperity is not a fancy. Prosperity must endure. So although economic growth is good and has helped change the way Africa is perceived globally, the social, political, and economic consequences of the limits of the kind and quality of the growth, leaving too many out of the share of its benefits are grave enough to deserve urgent solutions from policymakers, the academia, the citizens, and all friends of the continent. The principal reason that we must interrogate the quality of the growth, its composition, its distribution, and its beneficiaries is that we must seek to understand the underlying reasons for the exclusion of this large population of Africans from the cheery Africa Rising story. A growing Africa must also mean growing Africans in order for it to be sustainable. Finally, the approach that I canvass for addressing the combustible and implosive seeds of inequality in a time of growth is a replacement strategy for Africa's economic development. I call for a change in Africa's anchor on extractive or natural resources-centered economic development approach because I consider it per se for this era of Africa's development. I therefore call for a radical push that establishes human capital-centered economic development strategy as the only approach for ensuring prosperity for all. It is the fastest way for Africa's modest economic successes so far to gather real momentum that accumulates into true prosperity for a larger number. For me, a human capital-centered economic development strategy is one that simply places the citizens at the center of economic development policy choices. A human capital-centered economic development strategy ensures that each citizen is accorded more premium than oil, than copper, than platinum, than diamond. Because it is a development strategy that recognizes Africa's greatest constraint to equitable, inclusive, broad-based, and shared growth as being primarily the low productivity of the unit African citizen to create the values for exchange, which ultimately result in prosperity. Every one of you probably already knows the theory of human capital, and so it does not bear repeating. But one thing we know is that evidence shows that not a single country that placed the emphasis on human capital throughout history occupies the lower rungs of the global economic league table. Not one. By seeking to buck the trend and assuming that the education and the development of the human capital of the continent would happen as time goes by, Africa delayed the kind of development that should be coterminous with the Africa Rising narrative. It is therefore time for every one of us who has a voice to make the case for the use of the kind of indicator that the Africa Prosperity Report puts forward as a basis for determining the priority interventions that economies on the continent must make. Ladies and gentlemen, before the prosperity report, there was also the Human Development Index of the United Nations, a multi-dimensional index that measures performance, not just in terms of economic growth rate, but in terms of comprehensive well-being of the citizens. It is now time for Africans who the report on prosperity by the Legatum Institute suggests have done better in individual freedom, meaning that with political and democratic process becoming more prevalent in this continent, the individual African is freer to express with their voice. As part of Africa's prosperity, that voice must be included into the decision-making process for determining the priorities of focus of countries in shaping policies, in building institutions, and in determining critical investments. So, I want to end on the note that interconnecting the citizens, improved governance, and demand for accountability and transparency would ultimately result in moving the citizens away from the fringes of policy making to the center of policy making, where their capacity and their capability to operate in a growing Africa would find center stage. The average African citizen has been shown to be capable of competing where similar education and training have been offered. An example is what happened in a test case that we did with a Chinese firm in Ethiopia. This company, a leatherware company, was facing exactly the problem of high wages that has made the light manufacturing industries in China to be less competitive. Location has become everything for light manufacturing industry. And so, working together in partnership and in collaboration, this leatherware company decided to try out a partnership with the Ethiopian government, considering, as you know, that Ethiopia has one of the best hides and skin in the world. But it used to be exported in the form of commodity, extractive level. This company set up a plant in Ethiopia. And by making labor productivity the productivity of the Ethiopian and comparing it with the productivity of their Chinese counterpart working in their factory in China, they found that the Ethiopian worker could produce at the same level, comparable level as the Chinese counterpart. But what was even more interesting was that the Ethiopian worker's salary was so low that it enabled the company to still break even despite all the other logistical costs and the big transaction costs involved. So the company experimented further and provided more training and more capacitation for the Ethiopian workers. And their productivity climbed even further. Today, that company is on the way to setting up 4 plants for shoe production in Ethiopia. Its long-term goal is that within the decade, it would have about 100,000 Ethiopians producing leatherware for the rest of the world. For those 100,000 that would be capacitated and unleashed in the global economy, there is no better definition of prosperity than the opportunity they suddenly have to be integrated into a market that recognizes their worth. So I dare to declare that until we all became voices for Africa's political elite to take education to the center of economic policy, we would not have succeeded in canvassing for the unlocking of the potentials of Africa. I thank you very much for listening.
We're ready to take questions from, there's great conversation ongoing right now on Twitter, but we would like to hear from you here. One, two questions from the panel. Yeah. Good.
Thank you very much for your speech. I've learned a lot. I have one question. You talked about the example of Ethiopia, and you talked about the prosperity and how they've involved citizens of Ethiopia to increase their productivity. But you said the salaries are so low to the point that the company is having more profit. So is it prosperity for the company or prosperity for the people of Ethiopia?
Very good question.
Thank you.
Very good question. It's a question that you answer on the basis of counterfactuals. The counterfactual is that had there not been the existence of the company as a startup, the Ethiopian worker would not even stand the chance of a job. So the first stage was moving the Ethiopian worker from completely being outside of the economic process to being a participant in the economic process. The next level in human capital theory is, of course, that as labor productivity improves, so does the voice of labor strengthen. So does the negotiation of the value of labor also improve. And so it will not, over time, stay stagnant that the Ethiopian worker, which is exactly like what happened in China. The Chinese worker started like the Ethiopian worker. And then today, will not accept being priced at a level that enables capital to still function at the level where it now needs to find new location. So my point is, there are regulatory issues in labor pricing, but let's look at it from the perspective that it happens over time, that labor ultimately finds its real and true pricing. Of course, with all the caveats that are associated with the strength of capital compared to labor.
Thank you. When you stand up to say a question, can you please introduce your name and where you're from? I'll have a question here, and then we'll go there.
Thank you, Doctor, for your very inspirational talk. It's true that Africa has a lot of potentiality, and it is rising. But there is a problem, and a big problem, of there not being any transparency, and the problem of corruption. And this is so eating the, that any entrepreneur who wishes to, there's no way out without.
I think I get your point. That is why I said something about the voice of the citizen being important in the policy-making process. When citizens understand that what they have been faced with has been governments operating like the monopoly, like the monopolist, the monopolist has no incentive to be efficient or to be effective. The monopolist can offload whatever inefficiency they have to the pricing of the goods that the customer purchases. Now, what is the relationship between the monopolist and the African government? For as long as African governments supplied institutions of governance, supplied solutions of governance, without the citizens making a demand on the quality of the institutions and the services of governance that they considered desirable, the governments were operating and are still operating relative monopolies. And so the demand side for good governance, which happens through the voice of citizens, has to be the equilibrating action that Africa needs in order for there to be an equilibrium pricing model in the relationship between citizens and those that govern them in ways that would make corruption, bad behavior, costly for those governments that do not hear the ringing of the bell by citizens. Does that help?
We have a chance for two more. There's a hand here and another hand there. Your name and where you're from, please.
Thank you. My name is Andrew Mzava from the Commission of Science and Technology. Thank you very much, Doctor. You have reminded me of a very long story when I was growing up that don't give a man a fish, but teach him to fish. And when I grew up, I realized that the game is changing also, that you can have very good fishermen, and the city can have very good fishermen and very good business people, but the laws, the governance, the taxation and everything puts the fishermen in trouble. And I learned that I need to know how to own a pond. So how can you say about that on those governance and all those issues,
yes,
on Africa rising, not as fishermen, mm-hmm, but pond owners?
Yes.
Thank you.
Very, very, very important, and which is basically a way of saying that there are no silver bullets, right? And so that as you capacitate, I think one of the things that we've seen is that as people gain more voice, as people are empowered through education and gain more voice, then they understand how collective action can improve the success of everybody. And you need collective action at the policy-making level. The men, I'm so angry that you used the fishermen. There are fisherwomen also. Excuse me. they don't just sell the fish that are fished by the men. Some of them also control the boats and get the fish. So whether it's the fisherman or the fisherwoman, I think the issue is that the boat in the use of your analogy has to be on the basis that people understand that policy making process is too important to be left with the policymakers alone. So acting together and understanding the issues, what are the roadblocks, what are the obstacles to the growth of each of the sectors in which a capacitated African is operating, is going to be critical for that voice to be informed. You need informed voice of the operators of the diverse sources of growth on the continent into the policy-making process. There's often no incentive for policy reforms by those who are policymakers until there is pressure for change. Many times, people gather together in conferences and complain about policies that hinder their capacity to grow. But less time is spent organizing to push against the status quo that has hindered growth. It is time to stop accepting obstacles to growth. It is time for the citizens of the continent in various dimensions of life to make a demand for a better quality environment that frees them completely to be the best that they can be. Because it's a world of global competition. African businesses are not competing amongst themselves. They are competing with the rest of the world. If your competition is the rest of the world and you're accepting of national boundaries that cap your capacity, you're a goner.
A fisherwoman from Cameroon.
She's my kind of woman.
Yeah. The story of Africa is being written by others. Africa programs are conceived by others. Do you believe that in this context, Africa will be able to contribute with the wealth of knowledge which is ours, and which is left aside radicals? I'm not seeing the research institution of this continent contributing in policy making in our countries.
And I am not seeing that anybody is preventing us from organizing to become that. I am not seeing that in the year 2015 we should still be talking about others. I totally question this pliant, very weak Africa. Africa is not weak. Africans are not weak. We must push against this paradigm. It is no longer fashionable for us to externalize our failings. We must take responsibility for the failings that happen amongst us. We must look at ourselves in the faces and speak back to our policy elite and our political elite. We must not be weak, my dear sister. For you to be a fisherwoman in Cameroon, you are not weak. You can organize for the voice of the Africans to be the voices that would shape the next decade in Cameroon. I certainly know that you need to be questioning a lot in Cameroon. Because a certain leader of Cameroon is one that I knew when I was growing up. It is a Cameroonian problem. And so, the citizens of Africa have come to that point in history where everything about colonialism should only be a reference point, like what I did today. Most of our children on the continent today only know colonialism as an episode in history, and good for them. It is time to be totally unencumbered and to flap our wings. What is it that is not making us act together, integrate resources? Assuming our politicians are paying just political lip service to the concept of integration of the continent, what stops the mobile Africans from integrating? What stops us from using our own unique revolution in ICT as a basis to write our own story? Who is preventing you? I think this idea of the strong African citizen is one that I hold so dearly to. As a matter of fact, in my country, I have coined a construct that I call the office of the citizen. People love offices on the continent. They love the office of the president and the office of the minister, the office of the lawmaker. I love the office of the citizen. Because the office of the citizen is about the citizen that understands the boundless power that they wield in determining what kind of society they want to create. We are in Tanzania. You have a vista of opportunity again. In a couple of months, you're going to have to think of who would be leading this country. Am I correct? Well, who do you think is powerful now? Certainly not the politicians. It is the citizens. So are you going to define a future that is multidimensional in its definition of prosperity, or are you going to define one that continues with a status quo of achieving an average of 7% growth over the last 15 years or thereabout, and yet still a huge population of poor? Which one will it be? That's the power of the citizen. An active, informed, engaged citizen, eternally vigilant on the way that governance is offered, is more powerful than the office of the president. I leave you with the words of Thomas Jefferson. He said that eternal vigilance is the price you pay for liberty. There is no better definition of prosperity than liberty. Liberty, because it is the freedom to create, the boundless freedom to innovate, to try new things, to question old things, to completely assume that there is no box. Once said to my son, "You've got to think outside of the box." I said, "Where's the box?" "What box?" That's the new Africa. The young, when I talk about the need for us to place the citizen at the center of our economic development strategy, it essentially means that Africa must harvest everyone. The young must not be outside of the development process. The women must not be outside of the development process. No ethnic group should be marginalized and placed outside of the development process. It basically is an advocacy for Africa to see every African as that great somebody waiting to be unleashed on the world. I thank you again.